So, welcome to this class on Neuroscience of Human Movement. This is part 7 of our discussion on primary motor cortex. So far we have been discussing the activity of individual neurons, how that encodes force properties and movement properties and directions. So, in other words, we have discussed earlier the work of Edwards, Ebfitz, Georgopoulos, Kalaska, and Andy Schwartz, etc. We have discussed these things so far. In today's class, we will discuss what may have been considered or what may be considered a relatively more controversial approach to studying this topic. Suppose you apply relatively long lasting stimulation. In the previous cases, or in many of the previous cases, we have discussed recordings. So, in this case, suppose I stimulate intracortical using intracortical microelectrodes for specific times, depending on the context, you know, it produces smooth movements. Importantly, the time, how long the stimulation lasted, was relatively long. And compared with the classic neurophysiological approaches, where the stimulation lasts for a few milliseconds or two, but in this case, the stimulation lasts for a few hundreds of milliseconds, or say 500 milliseconds. The stimulation lasts for a relatively long period of time. What happens? So, this was a revolutionary idea in the 2000s. What was found with that? So, this is the work of Dr. Graziano. Okay, we'll discuss this. In the second topic, we'll discuss the somatotopy. What is somatotopy? Let's remind ourselves this. Somato means body, topy means map. So, we said early on, in one of the earliest discussions, we said that there is a map of the body present in the motor cortex and in the somatosensory cortex and in some other area of the brain. So, and we said that this map is representative of the proportion of neurons that are present, that control movements of specific parts, but do not necessarily represent, or there is not a strict boundaries between these areas. This is something that we said from the work of Wilder, Penfield and colleagues. Okay. How somatotopic is this? How somatotopic? Is there a strict boundary? That is the question. How somatotopic is the primary motor cortex hand area? This is work of Professor Mark Schieber of University of Rochester. Okay. We will discuss these two cases. So, suppose there is a monkey, and this monkey is stimulated. So, there is implanted electrodes in the primary motor cortex. And that is being stimulated. The stimulation lasts for relatively long periods of time. We said what that means. This is about 500 milliseconds. Relatively longer, much longer than the classical approach for stimulation. So, suppose that is happening. What is the result? How does the monkey behave? So, depending on which group or which area you are stimulating, the monkey responds in different fashions. In some cases, there is a response. So, when you stimulate, the response is the hand to, is the mouth movement like that. So, the monkey is trying to bring its hand to the mouth, hand to mouth movement. Okay. Or in other cases, when the stimulation is performed, the monkey is producing a defensive posture, the monkey is doing that, right. So, depending on the stimulation, movements are generated. Critically, the following must be noted. In the previous cases, what we have done? We have studied the correlations between neuronal activity and mechanical aspects of movement, such as kinematics or trajectories, force and its directions, magnitude, we saw these things, is it not? Magnitude means what? Works of eddy watts, Epfits, etc. Direction means the work of Georgopoulos, etc. Did not? This we have seen. And kinematics we saw just in the previous lecture, the work of Andy Schwartz. We have seen these things. Note, in this case, stimulation produces well coordinated movements of multiple joints. So, or in other words, movements are not necessarily activity of individual muscles, but rather when you are talking about a movement such as this, for example, or such as that, right. This movement involves activity over several joints, right. So, when I do that, when the monkey does that, activity is over our muscles in multiple joints are activated in some time series, right, in some temporal sequence. Now, that challenges the idea that direct coding of specific mechanical variables is probably not what is happening in the primary motor cortex, but rather it is the movements themselves that are encoded. This is an interesting idea, because movements are result of activity of multiple muscles. So, when I am making that movement, for example, movement is happening at the wrist joint, at the elbow joint, at the shoulder joint, is it not so? Multiple joints, and within each joint, multiple muscles are responsible for making that movement, is it not? So, for me to generate a particular trajectory or a particular time series of movement, specific time series of muscle activity must be encoded. But in this case, what we see, activation of the same neuron cortical areas produces movements that are relatively smooth and well coordinated over multiple joints, means that it is probably movements that are encoded in the primary motor cortex of live behaving monkeys. So, this idea has received support. This was the work of Graziano. This idea has received support from several other studies that supported this hypothesis. So, which leaves us with the question as to what is exactly encoded in the primary motor cortex, or what is the purpose or the role of the primary motor cortex. We have seen earlier it is kinematics, we have seen earlier that it is kinetics, now we are saying well coordinated movements. So, it seems like there are multiple roles that can be, our evidence points to multiple directions. So, still there is considerable debate in the field as to what exactly is encoded in the primary motor cortex. This debate, we will have a discussion about this debate in future classes. Okay. So, for now, this is the work of Graziano showing that long lasting electrical stimulation produces relatively smooth, well coordinated movements in monkeys. This could be multiple movements, some set of nice papers from this group. Please do read, those who are interested can read about this. Now, moving on, we come back to the topic of somatotopy. So, we said early on that Wilder-Penfield in the 1930s and earlier performed stimulations on neurosurgical patients and found movements elicited depending on the site of stimulation, and then he came up with a motor map. This is also called as the Penfield's map, very popular, is it not? This led hypothesis that if you activate a specific area, then you are going to activate the hand, and if you activate a specific area, you are going to activate the leg, and so on and so forth. Actually, Penfield never made claims such as those. He was cautious enough to point out that the proportion of the representation in the primary motor cortex is represented in the map, or in other words, there is a greater representation of the hand and the face areas in the primary motor cortex, and there is a disproportionately less representation of the foot and the trunk areas. This is what was claimed by Wilder-Penfield. However, this led to hypothesis that there is a map, there is a person, so you could there is a person, or this is also called as a homunculus theory, right? So, there is a small guy, or there is a homunculus in your head, which when you activate, depending on where you activate, the response is going to come. That was a controversial notion. So, this was tested by our colleagues Mark Schieber and Hibbard. Schieber and Hibbard, 1993, paper in Science. This side is activity of a set of neurons in the primary motor area, primary motor cortex of live behaving monkeys. So, now this is actually a zoomed in version of the same. So, let us take a look at the actual representations. Different colors in this picture represent different digits or the wrist, and the size of these circles represent the level of activity of the neuron. So, let us take one particular case. If yellow represents a particular digit, for example, you see that yellow is present. So, activity of neurons here is greatest, and then there are here, but you also see some yellows here also. Likewise, if you are taking blue, there is blue here, there is blue here, but there is also a blue here. You could do this analysis for any given color, and then you realize that actually it is not that each individual finger, between each individual fingers there is a strict boundary. If there was such a thing, what you will have is that there is a nice alignment of all the yellows and a nice alignment of all the blues and a nice alignment of all the greens and a nice alignment of all the purples. That is not what you are seeing. What you are seeing is that all these areas are mixed one after the other, or there is a great amount of diversity in, if I take a particular area. Let the other way of looking at this is to take a particular area and see how many different fingers are represented in that area. Suppose I take that area, for example, I know there are multiple colors, there is yellow here, there is purple here, there is blue here, there is yellow here, there is orange here. So, within an area, multiple neurons are present representing the same finger. Also, neurons representing different fingers are present in the same area. So, or in other words, if or in other words, there is a distribution of neurons that serve the same finger over a relatively large area. So, blue is present in that area overall everywhere. So, also yellow is present in a relatively large area. So, there is distribution. In other words, it is not like I have, this is the index area, this is the middle area, this is the ring area, and just to the left or right of that there is no other neuron. It is not like that. There are, in other words, it is not so somatotopic, or it is not a strict boundary between these neurons. So, what is present is a distribution of neurons that are representing each fingers, and if you take a particular area also, there is activity, there is neurons that support multiple sites. Okay. So, this is the work of our colleagues from Rochester, Mark Schieber, right. So, showing that the somatotopy is not so much within the motor cortex hand area. Okay. So, in today's class we saw the work of Graziano, and he showed that long lasting stimulations of the primary motor cortex leads to well coordinated and smooth movements in monkeys, and the work of Mark Schieber showing that the hand area of the primary motor cortex is not exactly somatotopic in the sense that there is strict boundaries, but rather the neurons that serve different fingers are represented or distributed over a relatively large area. Okay. So, what you are seeing, what is actually present is a mosaic representation of this. So, what you are seeing here is a mosaic representation. So, this is actually a mosaic representation. Also, there is great convergence and divergence. So, within one region of the primary motor cortex, the So, if you take any particular area like this, there is divergence onto multiple fingers. Also, neurons from multiple areas could converge onto the same finger. So, there is both convergence and divergence, and so there is this challenges the idea that the somatotopy in the motor cortex hand area is strictly present with strict boundaries between them. Okay. So, with this we come to the end of this class. We will continue our discussion in future classes. Thank you very much.